I was really curious after my PhD, I finished that 2012, I was curious as to where these technologies were going. So I started exploring them. So I'm going to go through just a couple, some of the big technologies changing the world. Artificial intelligence. I lectured AI for 7 years at university, and I couldn't even talk about it 5 years ago. It was still sci-fi. But what it is basically algorithms that will learn for themselves. They're modeled on things in nature. In a lot of cases, they're modeled on us and the way that we learn. And so it will go over and over and over data, and it will find patterns. The idea is we're generating so much of it, and a lot of businesses look into it to find out lots and lots of data. How do we process that and turn it into information? Artificial intelligence is very good at finding patterns in big data. So AI, why did it start getting projected into the public space? We had all these experts set the agenda for artificial intelligence for the next 30 years, and this was around about 6 years ago. So they set the agenda of all the milestones that were going to happen in artificial intelligence for the next 30 years, and guess what happened? They all happened within five, all of them. And then everyone went, shit, we're going to lose our jobs. So that's what happens, right? We fear the future. But what happened here was, this is one of the last events to occur, the last milestones. We had an artificial intelligence win at the ancient Chinese game of Go. Now, in the past, we've had Garry Kasparov, the world champion in chess, he got beaten by an artificial intelligence. We had Watson, IBM's Watson, win at Jeopardy. And then we've gotten to this point in time. Why is this one so significant? Well, Go has as many more moves than chess does as there are atoms in the universe. It's kind of difficult to just brute force it with lots of computing power. So the idea is it had to exhibit human intuition, and this is exactly what it did. It was able to beat the world champion in Go in June or July last year, but it was a massive event. Other technologies that are starting to spawn, I guess it's the stereoscopic cameras I was talking about on the front of the wheelchair, and the spherical vision cameras. Both of these systems are starting to be used in things like virtual reality and augmented reality. Who's tried virtual reality? Let's do it the other way. Put your hand up if you haven't tried virtual reality. Be honest. Wow, you've got to try virtual reality. Wow, you've got to try it. Don't try the mobile systems. Mobile systems are all right. They're still getting better. But if you can go into, say, there's a Microsoft store where you can try on one of the headsets that's tethered, you'll get a pretty crazy experience. And it's this interesting thing. There was a lot of investment put into virtual reality in the late 80s and early 90s. And it was like these big headsets that give you an incredible headache. It's what spawned movies like Lawnmower Man and Matrix. But what happened was it died out. It just wasn't the right time. Died out, kind of got overshadowed by the internet. The rise of the internet happened. Then we got our mobile phones. We're all talking about that before. Our mobile phones, our mobile networks. I was in high school when that really sort of started kicking off. My friend brought a mobile phone to me. He goes, isn't this cool? My first mobile phone, and I went, what are you going to do with it? I went, that no one else has one, so all you can do is call your mum all day. I was like, it is cool, but next thing, I was on the bus, and my friend, a few more friends got the mobile phone, and one of my friends on the bus, he goes, check this out, it's called SMS. And he texted, and then our friend outside the bus got that and then texted back, and we were just like, oh shit, we don't have to yell at the bus anymore. This is the future. So then we had the rise of the smartphones, and this was a really interesting thing, because what we had was a massive convergence of technologies. They jammed so many things in here, all these different sensors. And what did this do? It also gave rise to the return of virtual reality, which was awesome, because what we have is, in this smartphone, we've got a high-resolution small screen. We've got high computing power, massive computing power in such a tiny little thing. I'm sure you've all heard more computing power in this than what put the first rocket on the moon. People like to say that quite often. These are incredible, incredible little things. Then it's got an IMU in it. So it's got this device that tracks its own movements. We all know that our phone knows which direction it's facing and all of that. With those three innovations together, with those three technologies brought together, what we gave rise to was the return of virtual reality. You take this device, you strap it to your face with some cardboard or whatever you want. You get a couple of lenses so you can focus on the screen. Then what happens is you're looking at the virtual world in one direction. And as soon as you start turning your head, it recognizes its movements and it quickly pans the screen, because of its high processing power, quickly pans the screen, and you look in any different direction and you're still seeing something inside the virtual world from the direction that you're looking in. It becomes a neurological trick to the brain, and it tells your brain that you're actually there. Your brain makes it real, and it's an incredible thing. It's changing everything. So between virtual reality, where we go into the virtual world, to augmented reality, where we bring digital assets into the real world, like holograms, these things are all becoming possible now. They're all becoming real. So the idea here is technology and creativity, innovation, and diversity and inclusion, bring these together and we get a better future. So I'm starting to look into how these different technologies are going to impact our world, how we can create a more inclusive society. And I'm very interested still in the areas of disability and how these technologies can impact this space and make our society much more inclusive and include all of the statistics, but the numbers, the people, the perspectives that I've been seeing and all the different friends I've got who I just want to see what they can do and what they're capable of. With Jess, she is awesome. We went on this crazy adventure a little while ago. It was so good. I'd been to many concerts with Jess and I could see that she wanted to be on stage playing music, but there wasn't a musical device that she could play. We couldn't find a single one in the world that she could actually play, and we even tried getting her to press on the iPad. She could hit that with accuracy, but she couldn't hit it with timing. So we ended up going into getting a big team together very quickly. We had a very short time frame for this, 2 weeks. Now, to make this happen, we had a two-week time frame. We had a two-week time frame because we had already started selling tickets to this concert at the Opera House. We decided to think big and also to test the market. We sold the tickets to the Opera House. We said, Jess Irwin, a new musician, is going to play a newly invented device with her eyes to play music alongside the Australia Piano Quartet. We weren't entirely sure if anyone would buy tickets, and then the thing sold out. It was really cool, but we hadn't even started making the device yet. So we had 2 weeks to make this happen. 2 weeks to make it happen. I, of course, did not design that myself. I didn't even know what B-flat was. But what happened was I had to bring musicians into the room to help us create this musical device. I had to bring Jess into the room because I was designing for her. It was up to us engineers. It wouldn't have looked like this. It would have been a grid because we would have made great use of the sensor areas. We would have made a lot better use of the space. But we showed a few designs to Jess. She liked the idea of this pie thing. And, well, I said, it's not very useful for the, you know, the space of accuracy. It's more accurate towards the middle of the screen. She said, this is what I want, and this will motivate me to keep practicing. So we went, all right, we'll make that then. That's what you're going to get. And we brought artists into the room, we brought poets into the room, people who could give us a different perspective, because when you bring diverse teams together, you start to get different ways of thinking into a team, and that's what was so important to make this happen within 2 weeks. It was such a great moment for us and for our teams to realise that we were seeing the things that we each other couldn't see. That's the importance when you bring up any sort of team for innovation. You know, get people who are going to see things that you don't see, hear things that you don't hear. Our perspective on reality, as we've been starting to explore virtual reality, our perspective on reality is only what we take in through these sensors, these pieces of hardware. They get digitized, they get sent to the brain. It's how the brain processes it. We block out so much of the real world, so we actually all have different perspectives, even visual perspectives on the world. So this is what's so interesting about bringing these different people into the team and what we're able to create. Now, through a convergence of other types of technologies, through the convergence of cloud computing, of artificial intelligence, of biomedical technology, so things like the brainwave technology that I was using before, what I found through all of my journeys working with different people with high-level physical disabilities from all different types, what I was finding as a common thread was that the person usually had good control over their eyes because the eyes have such a direct connection to the brain. So even if there was no control over the other motor functions, the eyes have such a direct connection to the brain. So we went beyond this technology and went, okay, let's take this technology and this idea and bring it in to a new way of thinking as well, which was to go on this journey, becoming superhuman. It was my first TV documentary, and I thought, there's so much in the adventures of creating technology that people miss. We always see the outcomes of it. We should be taken on that journey of creation. So Riley here is 13 years old, loves technology, he's a brilliant kid. And Riley, he was born with high-level cerebral palsy, even higher than Jess's. So this affects all of his motor functions and his ability to speak. So he absolutely communicates with the world through his eyes, but he's so expressive and just a brilliant, brilliant kid. So his mum told us this story when he was young, that he used to stare at the lights and try and make them turn on, and he'd stare at the TV and try and make it change channel. And we said, that's called telekinesis. I said, that's what we're going to create. So let's create this idea, something portable that you can wear that picks up on the electrical activity of your eyes. So we'll get you to control the lights and control the TV. And at this point, when this photo was taken, I said, if you could control anything, what would you like to control? And he said, I want to drive a car. And I went, shit. Oh, you're only 13. And he goes, I want to drive a car. I went, don't you want to fly a drone or something, something we can crash? He goes, no, I want to drive a car. And I was going, oh, God. And so I started thinking about it, and then I went, we've got to think big. In this day and age, with this rapid rate of change, let's think big. So we got him an off-road buggy. I brought my team from Psykinetic, my social business, together again, and we looked into designing this buggy so he could take control of his world and take control of his dreams. Diversity comes down to human connection. Let's all learn to improve how we connect. What we're finding here is not only the different ways of thinking and the different ways of working together and innovation, but it's how we connect with each other, it's how we communicate. Sometimes we need to find new ways of connecting, new ways of communication, but this is what fosters diversity, and I think this is what's amazing about the time that we're living in. We're living in a world of rapid change. We're in the fastest rate of change the world has ever seen, but we're also in the slowest time of change that we ever will see, which kind of sucks, it's kind of exciting, it's kind of scary, right? But that, I think, is opportunity. It's opportunities for us to steer where these technologies go. Think different, think big. That's what we can do these days. And we are only limited by our own imagination. I think anything is possible.